kanami bin jang bezalok tela motta maung so kella dok shin tela minna di outte sharp minna babu se bon ke bal so tela di outte sharp minna anan do yini minna shiga na bon komon to shiga na bin jang bezalok tela motta maung so kella dok shin tela minna di outte sharp minna goba uzo si so Thank you very much and welcome everyone to our webinar. We are joined by various panelists in our webinar. My name is Jabulile Shongwe. I come from the National Youth Development Agency here in Mpumalanga, the place of the rising sun. And thank you for being given this opportunity to be the moderator for this session. The session is about access to funding and unlocking opportunities for our youth. Joining me as part of the webinar discussion, I've got Mpumezo Matibe, Mr. Mpumezo Matibe from NEF Investment Associate. And then I've got Mr. Manyata Nkuta, IDC Senior Youth Enterprise Specialist. And also with us, we've got Ms. Nozuko Choba, our NIDA beneficiary and owner of Zoo Zucchini. Welcome to the session, colleagues.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. As part of us celebrating Mandela Month, we have decided that let us have this webinar as the NYDA and invite our developmental funding institutions to discuss some of the challenges that are faced by our young people. We know most of our challenges that are faced by our young people is one of them is access to funding and how the requirements that are being set are stringent and young people are unable to meet the requirements of the funding criteria that is being set by these funding institutions. So as part of our discussion today, we are going to give our stakeholders that opportunity to interact with our beneficiary and also interact with our young people in terms of the topic of access to funding. I will give to NEF to, as part of the introduction, to talk about the approaches that are meant to address SMMEs in terms of financing challenges on the supply and demand sides, meeting their objectives. Over to you, Mr. Mpumezo Matibe from NEF.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm just putting some slides to share. I'm not sure if you guys can see them on your end.
Not yet. Yes, we can see now.
Okay. So I'm just going to give a bit of background, you know, before I go into, you know, the specifics of the crux of why, you know, we're here today, just to give a bit of background on who the NEF is and what our processes look like. So basically, the NEF, we were established a couple of years back through the National Empowerment Fund Act of 1998, and we are primarily mandated to advance Black economic participation, you know, with quite an added focus on Black women. And, you know, we advance financial and non-financial support to Black-owned and managed businesses. And we do this financial support in the form of debt financing with loans from 2,000 up to 5 million rands per transaction, up to 75 million rands rather per transaction. And, you know, just a brief highlight in terms of, you know, some of the things that we've achieved since inception. We've approved about 12 billion rands for investments in South African owned businesses. And I think the number is over 1,200 businesses. And, you know, we've created over 100,000 jobs. And we've achieved 17 years of clean audits running. And we collected, you know, close to 4 billion rands from our investees. And the sectors that we fund, we basically fund all sectors in the country, with the exception of gambling, alcohol and tobacco, as well as ammunition. And our funding projects, we do startup finance, we do expansions, we do working capital finance, we do mergers and acquisitions, we do franchise finance as well. The general funding criteria that we have is that you must be at least 50.1% Black owned. And as said earlier on, the funding requirement ranges from 250,000 up to 75 million rands. And we want to see operational involvement of the Black people at management and board levels. And the business has to control ability and the ability to repay the NEF loan. I'll unpack commercial viability and the other stuff later on in the presentation. And you know, we want to see social impact. We are measured on what we call empowerment dividend, which includes, you know, what the impact is on the socioeconomic aspects. And we know, as said also earlier, we want to see quite meaningful Black women participation. And you must provide a detailed business plan that is a financial model. I've got some tips around business plans and financial models later on, as well as you have offtake agreements or letters of intent that would be convertible into binding agreements with the with your customers, which would then back your financial projections. And in terms of our processes, just from application all the way to money being in the bank, we receive the application, we conduct screening and assessment, we do what we call a pre-due diligence paper that we take to an committee called Deal Forum. The Deal Forum will have a look at the paper and then grant approval to issue a term sheet and to conduct due diligence on the particular business. And then we go and conduct DD, which is about a week process. And then when we're done with that, we go and prepare a report back with all our findings that we would have come back with from the due diligence process. And then we take that to our credit risk department for adjudication, you know, background checking and credit checks on the business, as well as the owners of the business. And once that is done, we then go and approach our approving investment committees. So if a deal is up to 5 million rands, we'll go to just one committee for approval, which is the Fund Management Investment Committee. And up to 15 million, we go to the Exco Investment Committee. And up to 50 million, we go to the Board Investment Committee. And up to 75 million, we go to the last committee, which is the Board of Trustees. And once you've received your final approval from one of the committees above, then the drafting of legal agreements start, and then we review the agreements internally, and we send to the client to review as well. And then we collect a conditions precedent. So conditions precedent would be certain conditions that would be put in the agreements, and sometimes imposed by committee as well, to be a condition before the payment of the money is being made. Certain conditions that must be met before the payment of the money is made. Once all of that has been met, then we get to the final stage of the process, which is, you know, having the money in the bank. Then now, specific to today and just the tips around, you know, getting businesses to be positioned, and the approaches that we are taking as to help SMMEs. I spoke about commercial viability earlier, which is something that is quite crucial that we look out for when we make our investments, and especially primarily because the NEF is providing debt facility. So debt facility means that it's a loan that has to be repaid. So The commercial viability of the business needs to give us comfort that the business will be able to repay this this loan that they've taken from us, so that we can also go and rotate the money and help other people in the country. So we look at commercial viability in various ways, and I just summarized it a bit for today. The first one, you've got a product or service offering that you have, and this must address a specific quantifiable market need. So you must be able to say that this this particular product or service that I'm offering is appealing to this particular market, and there is this need for the product, and there is then willingness from that particular market to make a purchase of your product to satisfy that particular need that they might have. And also you've got the availability of the resources to make and deliver that particular product. And by these, we mean the technical skills and resources to make the product. So you do have the technical know-how in terms of creating the product, in terms of delivering the service, and you've got the resources around that. So be it equipment, be it a certain type of software, and you've got, you know, as I said, the skill in particular. And if there are certain input materials that must go into that product, you know, you've got the suppliers for that. You've got alternate suppliers, and in certain cases we'd want to see if you've got supply agreements to see that you will have adequate supply to meet the demand that will be coming from your market. And certain industries will require you to conform to industry regulations and certain certifications. So we want to see if that product or your business, as it's offering that particular product, has all the relevant industry regulations and certifications to allow it to offer that particular product. And then now we go to the market dynamics, which...
Sorry, Mr. Matsibe, can you also move with your slides as you are presenting? I think part of our viewers would want to see you moving with the slides of your presentation.
I'm not sure what you're, because right now I am on the commercial viability slide, so I'm not sure
where... It's still on the first slide, business positioning to access funding opportunities. It's the first slide which I'm seeing.
Okay, I've been on the next slide, so I'm not sure what the issue may be on your end. Can the other colleagues see the updated slide?
I don't think they are also seeing what I'm seeing. The first slide. Yeah, now it's moving. Thank you very much. You can continue.
Okay. So yeah, I think I was speaking to that first bullet point, which is the product or service offering. I've spoken to it, you know, the product addressing a specific quantifiable market need, and there must be then a corresponding willingness from the market to make a purchase of the product that you are selling, and there are resources available for you to make and deliver that particular product or service. In terms of, and resources, we mean in terms of the technical skills and resources. You've got the suppliers and alternate suppliers and perhaps supply agreements in place. And some industries will require you to have relevant industry regulations and certifications. And then now, in terms of market dynamics, you know, we need to understand, or you as the business, you must understand how big your market is and where you play in the particular industry value chain. What is your what is the niche that you are addressing within that particular market, and taking into consideration who are the other similar players within that particular market segment that you're playing on, and what then sets you apart? What's your competitive advantage? What would make people go to you over the other players who are playing in the same market segment as yourself? And, you know, we need people to understand what are the key drivers of the market that they are participating in and what its growth prospects are. You know, I think, you know, we've seen a lot of companies, even much bigger companies, you know, failing because of, you know, the failure to conform or to adapt to market trends. And, you know, we need you to be quite cognizant of what the drivers and the trends and the growth prospects of your particular market. And then there is the pricing component, which is quite important as well in determining commercial viability, because we want the pricing of your particular product or service to take into account at least the cost to make and deliver that product, take into account the fixed expenses that you have in the business, the cost of debt, if you do have any debt in the business, as well as the net profitability, which would be used for shareholder distribution or reinvestment for business growth, as well as then how does your pricing compare with the rest of the industry? So the benchmark of your pricing with the other players in the market, because you do not want to price yourself out of the market, and you also do not want to just go way too below the market, because it might be an indicator of a lack of sustainability in terms of your pricing. And then talking about sustainability, another factor that contributes to commercial viability.
Can we move to you summarizing, Mr. Matibe, so that we also give IDC the opportunity?
Okay. So we speak to, all right, we speak to how sustainable the business is, what the recurring nature is from your particular clients, and if you are able to get any ongoing sales. And I think quite important, before the IDC can even come in, and people, you know, tend to fail to understand what it is that we want from the business plans that they supply to us. It's one of the issues that especially youth businesses are faced with. And, you know, I just did a summary of the tips that I would provide to people about the business plans. Keep it clear and concise. Provide a full and detailed background of the business. Break down your product and service offerings. Add pictures if possible. Provide, you know, the technical process flow so that we get to understand everything about the business from start to the receipt of the product by the client. Provide whatever industry bodies and certifications you're part of. Provide details around your suppliers, as said, their background, their proximity to you, the payment terms that they are offering, and then provide an independent market study for a new business. And, you know, unpack your market, be specific to who your customers are exactly, list them if it's business to business. And if you've got contracts or LOIs, mention these and what their values are. And then unpack the terms that you have with customers. Are you doing cash on delivery? Are you doing 30 days or whatever it may be? Provide a human resource breakdown in terms of management profiles and key employees. You know, there's something that people in the investment space, you know, always say that we bet on the jockey more than the horse. It's quite important that you've got a proper management team in place as part of your investment proposal. And then on your finance section, provide a detailed Excel financial model. detailed revenue breakdown by product and customer, and a detailed breakdown of the input costs and expenses. And if it's an existing business, give us management accounts and the full annual financials. And another issue that people always have is that, you know, they don't provide a detailed breakdown of their funding requirement. Like, for example, you just say you want 10 million, but, you know, we don't know what that 10 million is going to be going towards, and it's not supported by any valid source documentation. So we need you to provide valid quotations to back that that requirement up. So I think we'll unpack more of the stuff during the Q&A.
Okay.
These are my contact details. People can take a screenshot of this or something. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Matiba. That was a mouthful, but I would like to request our team to be mindful of time, because we also have other the developmental funding institutions who also have to also present on the item. Thank you very much for that comprehensive presentation, Mr. Matiba. Let us go to IDC and give them an opportunity also to try and unpack in terms of the approaches. Do we see them helping the SMMEs in terms of the financing challenges, in terms of supply and demand? Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Guta.
Thank you, Jabu. I really appreciate the moment that you have given us to engage with young people and really tell them about opportunities that are available within the funding space. So, as I have been introduced, my name is Manyata Nguta. I will try to be short and straight to the point, because my colleague has really highlighted some of the important things which obviously are similar in terms of application and the like. So today I'm representing Industrial Development Corporation. Industrial Development Corporation is one of the biggest development financiers in the country. It was formed in 1940. The mandate is to really industrialize and fund industrial development within the country. So we, and obviously we fund a whole lot of a range of businesses. We have funded like billions of rands in the past few months, but a few years. But now, today, I will be speaking specifically by opportunities which IDC has for young people, and just really to tell you, so that when you approach IDC, you know that these are sectors that we are funding. We fund in mining, in aqua processing, chemicals and pharmaceuticals, in industrial infrastructure, clothing and textile, media and audiovisual, tourism, manufacturing, energy, machinery and equipment. So when you approach IDC, you should be at least in one of those sectors that I have just highlighted. And then, you know, what I also want to talk about is some of the challenges that we have identified for young people to get into market, to get funding and the likes. So one thing that we have identified was access to capital, because obviously young people don't have balance sheets, they don't have experience, and a whole lot of things that they do not have. So that is one challenge that is faced by young people. And then the other thing, if they get money, they don't have access to markets and opportunities. And I remember funding, when we funded a young man in Mpumalanga who was manufacturing coffins. So this person was manufacturing coffins. He made beautiful coffins, but he could not crack the market to get to the undertakers to sell these coffins. So the coffins were piling in the workshop. So that's one of the things. And then capacity and skills. I mean, we know that young people don't have some capacity, they don't have skills. So as we continue, I'll talk about some of the interventions that IDC is coming up with to try and close those gaps. And then there's this unconscious bias to youth. When a business is from somebody who's 21 or 22, some people are nervous if these people will be, if this person will be able to deliver, and so on. So that's one of the challenges that is faced by young people. And then so the other challenge is just a general problem that we all have, the slow GDP growth rate and so on. So the economic environment is just not conducive for young people. So, Jabu, I won't waste too much time. I'll go fast on one. So what IDC did, because remember, we fund industries, and you would not necessarily find young people in those big industries and chemicals and so on. So,
sorry about that.
No, that's fine. So what IDC has done has opened different channels. One of the things that we have is what we call SME Connect. So by SME Connect, we're trying to help young people in terms of access to market. So when we have funded, you will help you try and ensure that you access the markets that I spoken about, that this is, it becomes a serious challenge for young people. What we have also done within the IDC, we have a product called Grow eYouth. It's a scheme that is designed for young people, where it addresses the issue of pricing. So the Grow eYouth comes to young people at a very concessionary rate, and by businesses which are owned by young people, we talk about those which are 50% owned. But we also fund those which have youth participation. And there we say in any business which has a shareholding of at least 26%, it's youth participation. So we then provide concessionary lending at about prime less minus 3% for those that are owned by young people, and prime less 2% for those that are those that have youth participation. And then over and above that, we also have a program which we call Youth Pipeline Development Program. This one is, if you come to us and we like your idea and we see that this idea can work, we then provide a portion of a grant which will then assist you in, for example, developing market and doing this and the other. Before the application. So this is pre-investment, before the application can go to be assessed. So that will then help you to ensure that you meet the qualifying criteria of those strategic business units that I have mentioned, the agro-processing and chemicals and so on. So those are some of the things that we are doing for young people. But over and above that, you would know that before, IDC was here in Sandton, and then the regional offices were more marketing offices. Now, because we could see that young people are not able to access those opportunities everywhere in the country. So IDC then changed strategy a little bit. So young people can approach regional offices, where they can get up to 15 million rand of loans, and these are much more quicker. Because they are in the regions, you apply there, and the due diligence and everything that Pumizo talked about, that process happens in the region, thereby making it fairly quick for young people to access. So we say we are really encouraging young people to come and knock at our doors and see the opportunities that are available. Let me stop here, Jabu, and then we will maybe go into...
You'll be able to answer some of the the items that you haven't touched as part of your presentation. Thank you very much, Mr. Nkuta. Nozuko, from your side, now as the beneficiary of the NYDA, in terms of access to finance and unlocking business opportunities for intrapreneurs, what can you say as one of our beneficiaries in terms of the criteria that is being set by developmental funding institutions? How do you find it? Over to you.
Okay, thank you. And let me just take this opportunity to greet everyone and thank you for the opportunity again, Sissy. Being in business without a capital is not easy. So we just keep knocking on the doors and we hope that someone will believe in the idea that we have. And some of the challenges that I personally came across was, I think one of the things that Pumezo just mentioned was we don't have our financials in order. So we don't know how to package the product that we are offering. So it's not easy for the investor to understand if the product is viable or not. So those are some of the challenges that we have as entrepreneurs need to work on as well. So when we get to the funding institutions and they ask us for letters of intent, you have absolutely no idea what that is. You have absolutely no idea how you're going to get that. And you go to the big stores and you're trying to get the letters of intent and they send you left to right and center. And you even ask your existing customers, can you please write me a letter of intent? And they're scared to commit and they don't understand what it is. Even for, you know, it becomes so challenging and at times it can even be discouraging, you know, because we're really passionate about what we're doing. But at one point, you'll get that one person that will actually write you that one letter that will actually make you even to start understanding the market that you're about to tap into. Because I think most of the time we also unaware of the market that we want to tap into. We're unaware of what the market will require of us. So those are the things, I think those are the gaps that are in between us trying to access funding and us also being knowledgeable of what we want to actually access, you know. For me also, my journey was, I thought when I put in my application, I'm going to get funding now and I'm going to start rolling. Everything will be fine. And then you wait and you wait and you wait and you wait. And I guess that's the processes of the due diligence that the investing companies need to do as well on their side, which is something that we also need to educate ourselves as young entrepreneurs, that processes take time. And during that time, we need to not stop. You know, I remember when I was waiting for my funding from NYDA in 2019, I was still going out, putting my stand with my two crates and taking my mother's things from from home and just standing there in the street, and we started selling. And the moment when the funding actually came through, we hadn't stopped. So we had an opportunity to actually grow with the changing demand in the market, you see. So I want to encourage young people that during that time when you're waiting, you have to still be getting up and be passionate about what you're doing and keep knocking on more doors and actually sell your product. Because as you are out there and you see, first you think, I need money. And then you see that, oh, actually, no, my branding is, see, your branding is in order. And you're like, no, but I need to improve the quality of my product, you know? So if you're going to sit down and just wait and wait, then you won't get to learn some of those things. And by the time you actually receive your funding, that's when you now actually have some experience to say, I can best utilize these resources to achieve A, B, and C. I mean, when I got my funding from NYDA, I mean, it was just 50,000 rands, but my financials skyrocketed by over 300%. And had I not gone through that process of actually understanding that I need to get my books in order, because it was a requirement that I need to have a business account. And if I didn't have a business account, then my company does not have a financial record. You understand?
Yeah.
And I also say this to young people sometimes when they ask me, but no, I don't have money to pay bank charge. You need to have a salary at the end of the day. And that's the only way we get to build and to learn from the. And King, which I believe we as young people would need more enlightenment on, in terms of management accounts, we need better, we need more of that. Like it would be best if the funding agents would break that down for us in layman's terms. Like if I have my A4 exercise book that I'm writing down money in, money out, is that enough to constitute, understand an account? Oh, I don't have money to access an accountant who can actually prepare those books for me. Like we needed to be so basic for us that even a child in the village can access and actually access this funding.
Okay, it seems like we are losing you there, Nozuko.
When we talk about ability, again, goes back to saying, how do I then, the funding agent, see it as viable? And you are able to then support me.
We seem to be losing Unozuko there. We can't hear exactly what you are saying currently, Nozuko. I'm not sure whether you are losing connection or is it network issues in your area? All right, let me go to the developmental institutions again. Yeah, we seem to be, you are in and out of the conversation. You are in and out of the conversation. Can you move maybe from where you are and position yourself better? Whilst at the same time, I'll be taking maybe further engagement with the developmental funding institutions. We'll give you another opportunity. Mr. Matibe, are there any incubation opportunities or in terms of enterprise development products in NEF for young people?
Certainly we do. And I'll say,
can you move from where you are? I have given Ubudi to NEF an opportunity to tell us about other programs that they have at the NEF in terms of either is it incubation or enterprise development products which they have. Over to you.
Thank you. So we've got an incubation program. I think it runs two or three times a year, whereby we get a cohort of young people from across the country who we then put into a training program whereby they are being trained on, you know, some of the factors that Onozuko was speaking about, you know, in terms of financial management of the business, how you go about preparing your financials, how you package your business plans, and everything about that has to do about a business. So you are part of that program, and in fact, at the end of the program, as part of their examination, if you call it, they do pitches. So there's a panel of judges that sits, and the people sit in a pitch, and we assess, you know, how ready they are in terms of the training that they had just gone through. And it's quite important that process, because we then see if they need to go for more training, or we then determine whether these people are now funding ready or not, or we just show what are the particular issues that they need with. If it's market access, which is what Mr. Nkuta was talking about, you know, then we can see how we can assist. But it's quite a comprehensive incubation program. And, you know, we have had in the past people, you know, doing those pitches at the end of the incubation program, and then they actually go straight into the NEF funding process because they will be that ready at that point in time.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Nkuta from IDC.
Well,
on the topic, yes.
Yeah, no, thank you so much. I mean, as I indicated earlier, we unlike NEF, we don't have a specific incubation program, but we do have, as I said, SME Connect, which provides young people with access to market. We ensure that when we fund them, they have markets, and they have other as Nozuko was saying. So if for example we have funded somebody who is, let's say, doing whatever, and we find somebody who can complement that kind of business, so our SMEs, through SME Connect, we allow them to connect and to trade with one another. That also helps. But what I've also said was that we have a program called YPDP, which then helps young people to say, if your business plan, or maybe you're lacking something, we looked at the plan and we say, yeah, I mean, this makes sense, we can finance it. But it has some gaps here and there. So we have that funding, which comes as a grant to try and close those gaps. And that obviously helps young people to get at least so that their proposal has a chance to be considered favorably within the IDC. So from our side, those are some of the things which are pre-investment and non-financial support that we can give to young people.
Okay, thank you very much. I know if we can start unpacking incubation, it's a huge topic, as well as enterprise development. We might need more time than we're given right now. I'm seeing on the chat we've got young people who would want to interact with you guys and ask you questions. Andile, I'm not sure if we do have ones that you have identified for us where we can interact with the young people out there, because it's not about us. Also, they need to be asking questions and get answers from the panel. I think they are asking, there's one question on the chat where a young person is saying, dear NIDA, there are a lot of questions or issues that young entrepreneurs encounter when applying for assistance through this fund. How will this improve? I think here they are talking about the turnaround time. You've heard Ulentuza, Usisi, Unozuku. Sometimes it takes long for young people. They are so impatient. If it can take more than 2-3 months waiting for an approval for the application, for them it takes long. How can we improve maybe the turnaround time in terms of the approval? Let us go to NEF and see how can you answer to that.
Yeah, so look, from a turnaround time perspective, I think we need to be cognizant of the types of organizations that we are, I mean, that the development financiers are. Firstly, you know, considering that we are committee driven, that you must allow yourself a sufficient enough amount of time. And another thing that causes a delay in terms of the turnaround time, it's always largely on the entrepreneurs themselves, being not ready and You know, and as the NDF, there's a lot of handholding that we do to assist entrepreneurs to get ready and have all the information readily available. There are situations whereby we're able to close a transaction in a much quicker space of time. That's because the information would be readily available at that point in time. However, some transactions do take a bit of time because we need to go and assist the entrepreneurs in terms of packaging the information and getting it to be at the quality that we require it to be. And that's what would take a bit of time, not because, you know, we are just sitting and lagging, but, you know, it's because, you know, we are there trying to assist the entrepreneurs. And I think that it goes to show, you know, why we're also in the space that we're mandated to be in as well, because ordinarily in other finance institutions, you'd just be declined if you didn't have adequate information. But, you know, we come in and we assist with getting you to package your proposal in a sufficient and adequate manner that would be acceptable by our committees. And our overall turnaround time is, you know, we look at 6 to 8 weeks to close a transaction, which is quite a reasonable amount of time for a development finance institution. And if you have everything in place, and if you don't, that's when we come in and assist you and even connect you with other parties in the space. Sometimes we'll connect you with CEDA if there are certain things that we want to be addressed properly on the business plans. And, you know, so we go a long way in assisting you to adequately package your proposals to us.
Okay. Mr. Nkuta?
Yeah, I think that's a very important question. Sometimes you apply and you have an opportunity, and institutions take too long, and your opportunity evaporates while you're still waiting for your application to be processed. So that's quite a serious thing. But what IDC has done, and remember, and I think I need to also remind young people, remember IDC was actually established to fund industry. So if you going to consider a 150, 200 million rand deal, you have to do proper due diligence. But what we have done through our small business finance that I spoke about, that we now in young people can go to our regional offices and get funding from there. We identified exactly that to say, because IDC was designed to do big industrial projects, it took a little bit of time for assessment and so on. So with this program that I'm talking about, the small business finance, which is based in the regions, the turnaround times are fairly quicker because the investment officers and everybody else who's involved in the transactions is in the regions. So it's fairly quick to really get your application over the line. But what I would want to also say is that when young people approach financial institutions, they must have all their documents together, because sometimes they submit only a business plan, it doesn't have this, it doesn't have that, and then we have to call and write to them, and then information comes in trips and trips. So that is also a problem. So I'm just saying, my brother from NEF was saying, that please, I mean, he gave a hint about those documents that needs to be there and how the information must be packaged. So once you do that and we have information packaged well, it makes our lives easy in terms of fast tracking the application. But yes, we are trying to address that as IDC, as I've said, particularly for smaller transactions between 1 and 5 million rand.
Okay, thank you very much. Ms. Nozuko, do you think that they have touched some of the areas where you had also concerns? I've touched one in terms of the turnaround time. Do you feel that they have touched some of the issues? because we also have another participant from our live the audio audience is asking about the credit score. How does it affect the application? If maybe the credit score is not that good, or is it good? How does it affect the whole application? Can I give it to Ms. Nozuko first to just hear if Yena, she's covered in terms of the some of the challenges that she's facing? Over to you, Ms. Nozuko. Over to you. We seem to be having challenges with Ms. Nozuko in terms of her connection. I think, colleagues, if we can go to the question where our live audience are asking in terms of the credit score.
Okay. Thank you. I hope my network will not fail.
Yeah, her network is failing her dismally. Let us go to NEF. NEF, how does the credit score affect the application process for the client?
Okay, so we do two credit scores. We look at the business as well as the shareholders of the business. So, and in any case, we are investing in the business as a separate legal entity. However, we do conduct credit checks on the shareholders. It has a certain impact as it goes to show the behavior or the attitude that the entrepreneur has towards credit. And in as much as these are separate legal entities, the heart and soul of the business are the shareholders and the directors, and they are the ones that steer the direction of the business. And we need to be clear that the shareholders or the drivers of the business have a good attitude towards credit. So we wouldn't outright decline you, such as the banks would if you've got a bad credit score. However, we'll want to find out what were the issues that caused you to end up in that position. What have you done? What have you done about it? Have you made any arrangements with your credit providers in that particular respect? So it wouldn't be an outright decline. I have not heard of a situation where we declined a transaction because the entrepreneur had a bad credit score. We'd rather even say, go and make arrangements, and then we can continue with executing on the transaction.
Okay, thank you very much. IDC, as we wrap up, we're about to go to our conclusion.
Yeah, no. I think the attitude is exactly the same. We do credit checks, but we try and say to entrepreneurs what happened and so on. So yeah, our attitude is exactly the same. I think I don't want to say anything other than what my colleague has said. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Do we have you your connection back now, Ms. Nozuko? Because we're struggling to hear anything from your side. Okay, is your line better now?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Okay. I think I just wanted to add on the credit score that perhaps for us as young people, it's something that we really, really need to look into, because we come from a background where we actually do not get any financial education. So we don't really have a good relationship with using money. So if it can start from at home, whereby we begin to have that mindset of saying, let me live within my means, because that goes then to affect how you also manage your finances for the business. Do you, when you receive the money, are you going to reinvest into the business, or are you going to spend that money on items that will actually not bring a revenue for your business? So we need to start having those conversations and looking at ourselves deeper, because that credit score thing is something that's very important for us to develop and work on. And then also, I just want to add one more thing. Since I was cut off, I wanted to propose something to IDC. since you guys are focused mainly on the industrial sector, you know, I'm in manufacturing, and I find that for me, when I'm thinking about which equipment can best put me in at levels of volumes where I'm doing mass production that can actually supply the entire nation, I'm limited in terms of how wide I can actually get information. So if you could guys look at having showrooms, or maybe have a program that takes people in the finance, in the manufacturing space to spaces whereby we can look and actually see how this machinery works, and this is the conveyor belt into how the product is now packaged and everything. Like, just for us to get a bit, you know, even with my company, our hand sanitizer just got recently SABS approved. And now I've been on Google looking, where can I find, what can I use to stamp the best before date, you know? So if we can actually have something that's more.
Okay, there comes the network again, Ms. Nozugo. Your network is becoming also a challenge. Colleagues, I think we have come to the end of our session. I would like each and every one of you to share your contact details with our live audience, so that in case they would want to get hold of you. I've seen that there is one participant who's asking about the issue of grants for IDC, if you do offer grants. I've heard you saying that you do offer partial grants depending on the assessment. But I would like us now to conclude and maybe share our contact details with our live audience. Over to you, NEF, Mr. Matibe.
Okay, so my contact details, I had them on the slides, but my number is, my office number is 011-305-8051. So that's 011-305-8051. And my email address is matibem, so that's matibem at nefcorp.co.za.
Okay, thank you, IDC. Mr. Nguta?
Thank you so much, Jabu. About the grant issue, we IDC, we do not necessarily fund grants exclusively, as I said, that we would maybe if there's a gap in a business plan where we can actually provide some assistance pre-investment, we can do that. But it will only be maybe to close a certain gap that we have identified in the business, maybe the marketing or the financial part, things like that. But we do not really provide a grant per se. But obviously, because we report to Department of Trade and Industry and Competition, there are a whole lot of grants which are available from there, and that young people can access. So I really encourage them to visit our website and to see more opportunities. Our website is www.idc.co.za. And I think because they are young people, they are tech people, they can just go to that website and get contact details. Yeah, and then they can follow us on Twitter and other platforms. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Menozugo, do you have anything that you want to share with the live audience in terms of your contact information?
Okay. You can find our shop at shop number 2, Chesi Building, 42 Madeira Street in Mthatha. And we're reachable on WhatsApp on 065-837-9685. And of course, you can follow us on Facebook as well. You'll get all the information about our products and services. And thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, panel members, for your participation in our session today. That brings us to the end of our session. I'll also share the contact details for the NYDA. Young people knows that we are also available at www.nyda.gov.za. We are also now encouraging young people to be also on a fourth industrial revolution. So we are using a system which is erp.nyda.gov.za, where they can be able to load their own profiles and be able to apply for our services there. Our switchboard is 087-158-6345 or 5738. Or our email address is info@nyda.gov.za. There's also a customer care number, 0800-58-58-58. Thank you very much to the panelists for your participation. And thank you very much to Andile for organizing this session, our communications. And I hope, young people, you have benefited out there. Uzoyithola kanjani uhleli khona. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.